Welcome to Jung Tuition. This is a unique channel to explore, study, and share the knowledge about basic issues in physics and beyond. Today, I'm going to talk about Newton's gravitational law as part of the new series called What is Gravity After All? From Newton to Einstein. You might have been told by your school teachers that Newton discovered his universal gravitational law when he was hit by a falling apple. Nevertheless, that's just a tale. In ancient times, more people spent more time watching the sky at night. Some heavenly bodies are apparently moving, others seems fixed, but no one had any clue at all. Before Newton's days, the consensus had been reached by over 99% astronomers, namely, the Earth should be the center of the universe. Aristotle believed that, so did Ptolemy, who had numerically worked out the orbits for several visible stars. Of course, we know nowadays that some of them are actually planets. Here are some of the Ptolemy's orbits. Still, a general theory to explain the observed orbits on the Earth remained unknown for thousands of years. A truly paradigm shift was made by Copernicus, who first realized that the complicated Ptolemy orbits could be as simple as a circle if the Sun, instead of our Earth, is considered as the center. But Copernicus knew that this new idea could invite for troubles. This is a painting showing Copernicus had a look of his newly published book at his deathbed. What kind of troubles, you may ask? Have a look what happened to Bruno, who advocated the sun-centric theory. Relatively speaking, Galileo's punishment was mild, life in prison. Eventually, the sun-centric idea was adopted by Kepler, who was able to mathematically transform the observed orbits on the Earth into the coordinate with the sun as its origin. It was based on Kepler's theory that Newton came to formulate the invisible force between any two mass objects, including, of course, the apple and the Earth. It seems that Newton was so lucky that he might have only tried three integers, namely 1, 2, and 3, before he concluded that the gravity must be inversely proportional to the distance squared. Notice that the attractive force also depends on the mass of two objects. In essence, the force would be zero for any single mass object. In other words, gravitational force is meaningless for a single point mass in vacuum. However, the gravitational field and its strength, G, is often written as a single object quantity, Gm over r squared, which is alternatively called as the gravitational acceleration. As we know in Newtonian mechanics, acceleration is defined as the second derivative of the position of an object in space with respect to time. According to Newton's second law, the acceleration and the net external force on the object appear and disappear simultaneously. Therefore, both gravitational field and gravitational acceleration are merely mathematical symbols or a numerical notation for the presence of a mass object. It is necessary to note that gravitational field strength reaches to its maximum at the surface of an object, as it is easy to prove that the field strength decreases linearly to zero at the mass center when r equal to zero. No singularity whatsoever. Furthermore, the gravitational field strength can be written as the gradient of the scalar field called gravitational potential, denoted by phi. Using Gauss-Null, a Poisson equation can be derived, where rho represents the mass density. In passing, this is the equation to be used to link Einstein's metric tensor in his general relativity. It is important to know the Newton's universal gravitational law is not only quantitatively reliable, but also so simple. Even a high school student knows how to use it. That is why we still use Newton's gravitational law to launch satellites or send spaceships to the Mars, although we still don't know why gravity exists. In the similar way, we don't know why our brains work and why the universe is around us. In 1915, Albert Einstein published an alternative theory to describe gravitational interaction by using non-Euclidean geometry. I will discuss my latest evaluation of Einstein's ideas in conjunction with Newton's gravitational law. Thank you for your watching. Stay tuned. See you next time.